So now we're going to look at how would we apply Newton's method to a four-bar linkage. So previously we looked at how we could apply his method of numerical solutions to a single scalar equation, but what if you have a set of equations such as a set of vector loop equations? So let's real quick work out the vector loop equations for this, and then we'll go into how we would do that with a numerical solution. So here, if we go around this loop, say we go around the loop clockwise. So just standard convention, we have this one on the left, R2, which is called the input. And then R3 is the coupler, and R4 is the output. And R1 is the ground. All right, and we have our X going along the ground. So we'll write our vector loop equation. And that is R2 plus R3 minus R4 minus R1 equals zero. So I'm not going to go into a whole lot of details here because this has been covered previously. But then we need to split it up into the position scalars. And we'll get the x equation and the y equation. So because this is a loop, obviously these are supposed to equal zero, and we pretty much just break this all down into sine and cosine, recognize that R1 only points in the x direction, and we can write R2 cos theta 2 plus R3 cos theta 3 minus R4 cos theta 4 minus R1 equals zero, and then R2 sine theta 2 plus R3 sine theta 3 minus R4 sine theta 4, and then R1 is not in the y direction, so we just have zero. So then known are all of the constants, which would be pretty much all of the link lengths, R1, R2, R3, R4, and then finally the ground angle theta 1. And then our input, we had already decided we get one input because this has 1 degree of freedom. So we standard convention input is theta 2. Let's say that. And so then the unknowns are theta 3 and theta 4. Okay, so let's say we want to solve this to figure out for a given position of the input, what values of theta 3 and theta 4 solve this? So we could solve it algebraically. It is a hassle, as we have previously seen. So we can use Newton's method to just approximate and get as close enough to using that guess and check method of what are theta 3 and theta 4. Solve for that. So we need to basically use the formula. So before we had f of x. Negative f of x over f prime of x plus x to the n equals x to the n plus 1. So that's x in, x in. So that was our basic formula for our guess and check. And that came from knowing that f of x in is pretty much, let's see, f of x plus f prime of x times x, sorry, it's f of a, f prime of a times x minus a. So that was to approximate this function, where now we're having vector loops. So instead of f, we're going to be using our position scalars, x, y. Instead of x, we're going to actually be using our unknown. So ours is going to look something like this. And we set f of x equal to zero because we want x and y to equal zero. So basically, in order to guess and check, we're going to have something that looks like theta n plus 1 equals theta originally minus j inverse, because it's matrix, so we have to use the inverse, times F. Okay, so these are all matrices. So theta is going to be theta 3, theta 4, and that is n plus 1. So the new guess equals theta 3, theta 4, before minus J inverse times our F, which is the X and the Y from the position scalars. So this is the formula that we would use to solve that vector loop. So pretty much we have the theta column. So we'll say thetas. Theta matrix represents the unknowns. The F matrix is the position scalars. So X and Y. And if you had multiple loops, so this here is, you know, two rows. The Jacobian will be a 2x2 matrix. We'll get to that. F will be a 2x1. But if you had multiple loops, then it would grow by that much. So you would have like a 4x1, because you'd have four. If you have two loops, then you'll have four equations and four unknowns. And J would be a 4x4. Okay, and so then J is the Jacobian, which is the coefficients of the unknowns from the derivative or the partial derivatives of the functions. Okay, so we want to take the partial derivative. So J equals partial derivative matrix. So the partial derivative of the function, instead of just f prime, it's going to be partial derivative of the function with respect to that variable. So in J, the rows correspond to the X and Y position equations. The columns correspond to theta 3 and theta 4. Okay, so in our Jacobian, we will have del X, del theta 3, del X, del theta 4, del Y, del theta 3, and del Y, del theta 4. Okay, so that gives us the Jacobian, and we can actually get those exact things. So the X equation, we get a partial derivative of that with respect to theta 3. So that means that we say that theta 3 is the only variable. Everything else is a constant. Take a derivative. So we've got derivative of cosine is minus sine, and so we will get negative R3 S3. And then same thing if we did it for the Y equation, we would have derivative of sine is cosine, so we will have R3 C3. Okay, so now the theta 4 stuff, which I'll just highlight here. So we got that and that from taking derivatives of these two. So now we will take the derivative of this negative R4, C4, and that will go here. And then we'll take the derivative of the negative R4, S4, and that will go here. So negative R4, C4, derivative, cosines minus sine. So then we get R4, S4. And then down here, derivative negative sine is negative cosine. So we will get negative R4 C4. Okay, so this is the Jacobian matrix that you would use. And if you're programming this into MATLAB, then you will define F as the X and the Y equations, type those all out. Then you will define your Jacobian here, also inside of the while loop, and then you'll be able to use this formula with the matrices in order to solve for your new guesses, iteratively get to until F actually equals close to zero, and then you know what your answers are.